introduction from last week. So last week, Peter and John encountered a beggar on the way to the temple who had been born lame, which was not only debilitating, but it put him on the outskirts of society, unclean and outcast. The beggar was asking for a handout, and Peter told him, "I don't have any money, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ, stand up and walk." And he took him by the hand and raised him up. This man, now healed in body and spirit, verily leaped for joy. And they enter the temple together. Not only is his body whole, but he is able to join again the community of faith. As you might imagine, this caused quite a commotion, for the people were, quote, filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to the man who was born lame. And that brings us to the continuation of the story as the man clings to Peter and John.
Reading from the book of Acts, chapter 3, verses 11 through 21. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's Portico, utterly astonished. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk?" The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, God of our ancestors has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him, but you rejected the holy and righteous one, and asked to have a murderer given to him. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself, has made this man strong, whom you see and know, and the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, and did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and he may send the Messiah appointed for you, that is Jesus, who must remain in heaven until the time of universal restoration that God announced long ago through his holy prophets. This is the word of God.
God is still speaking. Thanks be to God.
Oh my God, there is life in you. We need only put our trust in you. Surrender. Let your love and mercy rule in our hearts. Bless the speaking, the hearing, and the living of your holy word. Amen. Faith that gives life. There have been many times in my own life when the Lord has lifted me out of some kind of trouble. I've seen it happen in the life of others as well. But whatever the situation, whatever the problem or circumstance, whatever the state of mind, it has been my faith in a God of resurrection and new life that has fed me with the living water of Jesus Christ. Faith has the power to restore, to heal and forgive, to even bring about a resurrection and give new life. It is faith that gives life, and we do well to hear Peter as he talks about the power of God. To say it lightly, Peter had the people's undivided attention. As Scripture says, they were, quote, utterly astonished. It's not every day you witness a miracle. They knew this guy who was claimed to Peter and John. He was a lame man who used to beg at the gate on the way to the temple. And here he was, walking and praising, barely leaping for joy at what God had done. What better time for another sermon? And so Peter addresses the crowd, and please keep in mind that these were fellow Israelites. They were Jews who had made the pilgrimage to temple to pray. "Why do you wonder at this?" Peter asked them. "Why do you stare at us like we're something special? It's not us. We don't have any special power, and it's not because of any piety either on our part. It is the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the God of our ancestors, who has glorified his servant, Jesus. This man has been healed by the name of Jesus Christ." Now, I love the humility in Peter's heart in this scene. Peter knows it's not because of him. I mean, Peter is just as weak and human as the rest of us. And yet, my friends, Peter also knows that with surrender and faith comes great strength and power. Not I, but Christ in me. It's that faith that gives life. Peter continues, and once again he reminds the people of their sin, the great evil act they perpetrated in having Jesus killed. As he had done in his first sermon, Peter uses the emphatic "you" again. "You were the ones who handed Jesus over to Pilate. You were the ones who rejected the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be released instead. And you were the ones who killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead." Three times, "you." Now perhaps the people gathered there were the ones who were actually in the crowd that day and shouted, "Barabbas." But they were just as culpable. For us living 2,000 years after these events took place, it's easy for us to read this as Peter putting the blame on a select group of people. In fact, this is another one of those passages that Christians have used to justify mistreatment of Jews. But Peter's point is not to single out any one group, but to remind everyone of our own culpability in rejecting and killing Jesus. Even the apostles failed Jesus. And we know that Peter denied him three times. Every single one of us, we know, falls short of the mark of Christ. We all sin. We all have our moments when we reject the one who gives us life. And yet, though we sin, it is God who brings forgiveness. Though there's times when we reject what the Lord is doing, it is God who invites us back into the community of faith. And though Jesus was killed, it is God who raised him to new life. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. I'm going to ask, can you move the slide one time? I have a little illustration for us. In this simple statement, that simple statement I just read, through polar opposites, Peter demonstrates a kind of parallelism in God, and this was loved by the Hebrew poets who did it all the time in the Old Testament. On one side, there was you, but on the other side, God. On one side, killed, but on the other side, raised. On one side, Jesus was dead, but because of God, he was raised and given life. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. Faith that gives life. But as assuring and powerful as that realization is, Peter is just getting started. Though God did an incredible, wondrous, powerful thing in the resurrection of Jesus the Christ, God is not done with us yet. Faith in Jesus made this man strong, healed him, and made him whole. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead has now redeemed the life of a crippled man. The Easter moment may be the single greatest act of redemption of God, but the true gift of our God is that Easter lives on again and again. The floodgates have opened, and the Lord is here to bring healing and forgiveness and new life. not in some one-time event, but in the ongoing power of faith in Jesus Christ. At this point, Peter comforts the people, noting that they acted out of ignorance. In fact, in this way, God fulfilled what had been said by the prophets that the Messiah would suffer. There is no judgment, no condemnation on the people's sin and culpability. Peter exhibits a faith that knows that God can even use our mistakes, even our sins, to bring about a greater glory. And that's amazing if you think about it. And for everyone who thinks that it's up to them to get it all right, it's a wondrous affirmation and comfort to know that God is so much bigger than us. And even our sins might be used for a greater good. But in the moment of revelation comes the invitation to change your life. God does not desire your death, but that you turn and be healed and be given new life. Repent, Peter tells the people whom he names friends. Repent and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out. Change your life and embrace God so that the slate can be wiped clean and you can start again. It is the gift of a new beginning that Jesus Christ offers. And if you follow the lectionary, it actually stops the passage at that point, and actually even in mid-sentence. But I thought it was better to go on just a few verses to see where Peter was going with this. Repentance, turning your life over to God, that takes care of the past and all of our missteps and our mistakes. And it also gives us the present reality of forgiveness and new life, which we know and our faith tells us. But God's power, we know, is also projected into the future of Jesus Christ. Peter tells us times are coming where we will be refreshed in the presence of the Lord. The Holy Spirit will come upon us. God is not done with us yet, for the Lord will bring about a universal restoration. It is faith that gives life. Now I want to share a story with you about something that happened at a church that I once served. It was a church before this one. It was a rural congregation in Texas near Washington on the Brazos State Park. Some might say it was behind the times in terms of acceptance. I had not been there but a couple of years, and it was time for our annual Women's Sunday. And the women from the evening guild led worship. Some of the men weren't too happy about that. But in the past, I had been able to find a woman to fill the pulpit. But this time, for whatever the reason, I couldn't find anybody, so I was just going to preach myself. And on Monday, I get a call from one of our members, Vivian, who asked if I still needed a female preacher, because she knew somebody that would do an amazing job. It turns out that Vivian's son and daughter-in-law had a nanny for their children, a person of incredible faith who the family had grown to love. And the nanny was a minister at her church, and the family had gone to hear her preach. And after hearing her, Vivian said, "This lady is outstanding." And so I said, "Sure, let's line it up. I think it'd be great. But she's black." Well, my naivete, I said, "Well, I'm sure there might be a few that take offense, but it'll be all right." It caused an uproar in that rural town in conservative Texas. The phone lines were buzzing. People were talking and arguing back and forth. There was talk of a boycott from church service. Now, my parents had raised me that the color of a person's skin did not matter. And I couldn't believe we were even having this discussion at this church. Here I was, the Yankee. I couldn't believe they called me a Yankee. I was from St. Louis, but I was a Yankee. So, and, you know, I was like, what is this, the 1950s? At one point, I was talking to the woman, the president of the Women's Guild, who thought she should have been informed about this preacher, you know. And I said along the lines, install another water fountain in the hallway, you know, for people of color. And I was really mad at them. And it was a test of faith for me. And it was a test of my leadership. And I can still remember one night in Austin. It all had blown up. I had gone to Austin to be with some friends, and I was staying over, and I couldn't sleep. And it actually snowed that night about 2 a.m. And it was one of those get on your knees moments. And I was there with Christ, and I just sobbed. I just cried. And you know when you're so upset, and all you can sort of do is lay on the floor and in the fetal position. I mean, that's where I was at. But the Lord came to me, and I found strength, and I found grace to move forward. This rural congregation, they were all white. They had a German background. They were surrounded by African Americans, the location of the church. It didn't help that the Germans were pretty much the landowners in the area, and the African Americans in the area, they were so poor. They were so poor. Further, the evangelist of me at this church had already been encouraging the church to reach out, to invite folks to come, to make them feel welcome. I soon learned that the congregation, they did want to grow. There were just certain people who were not welcome. Now, I had my own cross to bear in all this, but truthfully, it was Vivian who was attacked. Well, she should have known better. Well, Pastor Ron doesn't have a problem with it. Well, of course, Pastor Ron doesn't have a problem with it. He didn't grow up here. And so the conflict continued to escalate. And poor Vivian. I mean, people who she thought were good and dear friends to her, friends for a lifetime, people she loved, they turned their back on her and said horrible things to her. She was ready to quit. She called me during the week. She said, "Let's just call this whole thing off, Pastor Ron." So I went over to her and I visited with her. And I pretty much told her, I said, "Look, there's right and there's wrong. And we need to do the right thing here, Vivian." So I would not let her quit. This was just too important. And through all this, prayer, I mean, Vivian had those moments too. She was on her knees. She felt overwhelmed. She was getting attacked. She was crying out in anguish. "God, you know, just let this pass. I don't think I can do this anymore. Why, Lord, why? Why are people treating me like this? Please help me." Though it cost her pain and grief, and it cost her some very dear friendships, the Spirit moved. And in the end, Vivian said to her, "Lord, not my will, but your will." She decided she would not back down. She had found the faith that gives life. On the next Sunday, there was a kind of hole in one place where certain people were absent. But in other ways, the church was filled. It was filled to the brim. The area around Vivian especially was so packed, so full. All her friends and families, they all crammed around her to show her their support. The lady preached. She did a wonderful job. She preached a message that was very appropriate for the church and where they were coming from. And in the end, I'm happy to report there was some reconciliation that happened in the congregation. One friendship that was very dear to Vivian was healed. Sadly, another was not. And through it all, the church grew spiritually. But as you might guess, the greatest strength and growth was in Vivian. That test of faith made an incredible impact on her life. She became a much stronger person because of it. Because our faith, it is our faith, my friends, that gives us life. Consider your own life. Your own journey of faith. Do you feel fed by the Spirit? What are you doing to help with that and help enable the Spirit to come into your life? Where is the Lord leading you? And how can you offer hope and healing to another person. Perhaps you're carrying a burden as well at this point, struggling with something in your life. Look for God and look for the healing that is there. Find that faith that gives life. Amen.